are listening to the M3 Summit, your source for all things rock and roll.
On, and here we are, everybody.
Yay!
Everybody, give it up for the new guest, Steve Brown, man. Thank you so much, Steve, for being here with us. Dude, what a cool dude.
Hey.
What a cool dude.
And everybody out there in the internet world, how are you? And hope you're healthy and safe.
Awesome. All right, so the M3 Summit here, we are like five guys from the East Coast of United States. Sometimes we have Mitchell Lafon from Canada. And, you know, we just talk about rock and roll, man. And in this opportunity we have this guy is amazing. We saw him live, you know, in the M3 last year with Danger. And, you know, like I was saying before we went live, you know, like... Steve came to the press room, you know, super cool, you know, with a smile. Everybody was laughing, joking around, you know, relaxed. That's what I want to see, you know, in a festival. You know, that's the environment that I want to, you know, this brotherhood, you know, that's what it's all about. And everybody else here, you know, Steve Presto, Psycho Steve, Jay Oakley from Maryland, Psycho Steve from New Jersey, Angel Alamo from New Jersey, and Bobby Dreher from Philly. Monco Radio.
Yeah.
There you go. Guys, you have questions, you want to say hello, the show is yours, man.
First off, Steve, thank you so much, man. It's a pleasure to work with you again.
No problem, dude. Yeah, it's great to be here with you freaks. And yeah. I say that with all the love in my heart because we're all a bunch of rock and roll freaks, and I think we're all a little... At this point in the whole coronavirus mania, we're all getting even a little freakier because we're all stuck inside. So luckily, I got this cool studio in my house that I've been living in for the last 2 weeks, just doing a ton of work. So I think I'm somewhat sane, but you know, you guys can be the judges of that.
Well, you did get to play out a little bit recently because you just had a show with your friends in Rubik's Cube recently.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that was the last in New York City before the shit hit the fan. No pun intended. But yeah Ruben, we played Brad's 50th birthday party a couple weeks ago.
Absolutely.
So I got a couple things to throw at you, Steve. One, Tokyo Motor Fest. Is there going to be a Volume 2?
The Volume 2, yes, certainly. We just actually turned the record into Frontiers. We finished recording, mixing, and mastering about 2.5 weeks ago. And so we're just, you know, unfortunately, you know, with everything that's going on in Frontiers Records, you know, they're based in Italy. So as we all know, that's kind of the epicenter of this whole virus pandemic. So we're waiting to see when the record's coming out. But I can tell all the fans and all you guys, you know, it is phenomenal. I think as an artist, it's my best work, writing, playing, singing, you know, all the things, producing, all the hats that I wear, making a record. And, you know, Ted Poley, Greg Smith, and Chuck Berge just, you know, just crushed it on the record. And I can't wait for the world to hear it.
That's great. Part two of this. Where did the name come from? How did you come up with Tokyo Motor Fest?
Well, you want, let's go with the short answer. Real simple was... I'm a big name guy, you know, I named all my bands pretty much. Trixter, you know, Throwing Rocks, Soaked, 40-Foot Ringo, Stereo Fallout, whatever it is, Tokyo Motor
Fest. Sugar Belly.
Yeah, Sugar Belly, yes, that was one of my greatest names ever. But it's always been a thing of mine, you know, and people think I use that computer thing, band name generator, nah. I got a trusty notebook, like I have all my lyrics and all my crap laying around the studio. I kind of live my life where I see things in my eyes and I always, like, I tell my kids and my wife or whatever, I say, oh, that's a cool album cover, you know, and then also, oh, that's a great name for a band or that's a great name for a song. So I always have stuff in my head and I'm really good at documenting things. So for the last 20 years, I've had band names all around in my notebooks and whatnot, put them in my phone. And I started this project a couple of years ago with Greg Smith, and it was a bunch of different guys, and we had to come up with the name for a band, and I don't know, I just came up with Tokyo Motor Fist. You know, it was kind of like, you know, I always thought Motorhead, as we all know, is kind of the coolest band name ever, coolest rock band, heavy metal band name ever. So, you know, my attitude is anything, any band with the name Motor in it has got to be cool. So I was like, all right, it's got to have a motor in it. And then I'm like, well, I just got back from Tokyo. I think I was there with Martin. And I'm like, I love Tokyo. I love Japan so much. So Tokyo Motor, go with that. And I was thinking, you know, it could do the metal horns, but Tokyo Motor Fist. And I wrote it down, and I was like, this sounds so fucking cool. I love it. And I showed it to the guys, and everybody laughed. So that's the cool thing. You know you got a good rock and roll band name when you show it to your band members or show it to friends, and they don't laugh. They didn't necessarily say it was the greatest name, but they didn't laugh. So I knew we were on to something good. And then that's it, man. And the rest is history. We're getting ready to release our second record. And just got done playing the Monsters of Rock Cruise. Had two fantastic shows there. And, like I said, I couldn't be happier playing with the guys. It's a real band. You know, that's the one thing. It's not one of these Frontiers Records fake super groups, bands that never play live. They make a record. We're a real band. You know, the guys all chuck, lives eight miles away from me up in West Milford, New Jersey. You know, Ted and Greg Smith are out in Pennsylvania, like an hour and a half away. So we're close together. We get together all the time. We rehearse, play. And, you know, we were looking forward to a really busy 2020. But I think at this point, we're looking at a really busy end of 2020, maybe early 2021. But, you know, it's a fantastic band. And anybody who has the first record, the reviews have been phenomenal. And, you know, it's a from the heart project. It really is.
Steve, tell me about the logo. You know, on the side of the screen, we can see the logo. I mean, of course, you were talking about everything that has motor. You know, and we see like, what is that? A motorcycle? It's an engine. What is that about? Tell me, how do you come with that logo?
Well, that was the art people at Frontiers. You know, put that together for us. But it was definitely my idea to have something. You know, it's all about having something like I said before. That's cool looking. Tough looking, and rock and roll. I don't really know. I mean, listen, you come up with a name like Tokyo Motor Fist, what do you think you're going to put it on? You're not going to put it on. It's not really going to look good with flowers. You know what I mean? You put it on a motorcycle engine. You know, it kind of tells, you know, it's what it is, man. It's a powerful, I guess, you know, I could equate it to Tokyo Motor Fist. It's a powerful musical machine.
Yeah, definitely. Hey, we have some people joining us live. Kevin Almeida says, "Sup, Steve." Aaron Shepa. Saw Steve in New York a couple of weeks ago. Great guy. Matt Potter says, "Yay, Max's mic is working," because last I have problems every time with my microphone, but now it's working, so I'm happy about it. And yeah, man, like, so that's it. We have 12-15 people join us, you know, little by little. They are joining us. I share this interview all over the media, you know, all over the Facebook groups, everywhere. So, you know, Angel, you're very quiet, man, and you're a huge fan of all Steve's work. So go,
yes,
go
yes,
for
I
it,
am.
Brother. Go for it.
Yeah. Would you ever do a solo record?
How do I answer that? I think I've done enough stuff to where people know. I mean, there's part of everything that I do is a solo record, you know, in a sense of the way I produce and the way I make records. Not to take away from anybody that I work with, but you know, it's like my songs are done with me singing. It's so all my bands that I'm in is so much me. I don't really have any need. I have honestly no real desire to do my own solo record. If you go back and listen to 40 Foot Ringo stuff or the Stereo Fallout stuff, I mean that's pretty much what you're going to get as far as hearing me saying, on all the trickster stuff, those songs were written with me singing before, and I would give Pete a demo of the songs, and he would take my direction, take what I did, and try to take it to another level. I don't honestly have that desire to do it because I think there's enough. I think I get out all that I want to, whether Ted's singing it or Pete singing it, or whoever else. I don't know who else I'm working with. But, never say never. I mean, at this point, I'm just really happy doing what I'm doing, as far as Tokyo Motor Fist and producing stuff for other people that I really just don't have any... Again, a burning desire to do a solo record. I don't think I have to prove anything to anybody, most importantly myself, about what kind of artist, the writer, or singer, or guitar player, or whatever I am. So I'm cool with that. But again, you never know. You know, I'm coming into 2020. I'm coming into my 50th year. I'll be 50 in July. And I got a lot of music in me left. So maybe. Go ahead.
Go for it.
Well, who's next? Steve, come back. Are you there? Okay, yeah, I'm here. I'm talking about Psycho Steve.
Okay, so my question is, was guitar your first instrument?
What's that?
I said, was guitar your first instrument?
Yeah, and it's only your first guitar. Yeah, guitar was totally my first instrument. I mean, I started playing music when I was a real little kid with my grandfather back in Paramus, New Jersey. My grandfather had a piano, and he was kind of a cool, you know, kind of, you imagine like an Irish pub playing, and he would play, and I remember when I was really young, he taught me how to play chopsticks, and so that was the beginning of my musical, playing, but of course it was... You know, discovering Kiss and Van Halen in 1978 that completely changed my life forever. It was Rock and Roll Over by Kiss and Van Halen 1. And within, I think, weeks of discovering both those records, I was at a local music store in Maywood, New Jersey, Musically Yours, and I started taking guitar lessons. And it's worked out pretty good ever since.
Awesome. Do you still own the guitar that you learned on?
No, I don't, because, the first guitar I actually had, and you'll love this story, was a rental, so it was a real bad acoustic guitar. You know, I think my parents paid like $10 a month to rent it. And what's funny is when my mother took me in to take guitar lessons for the first time, she took me in the shop, and the guy at the music store goes, is your son left-handed or right-handed? She goes, well, he's left-handed. And he said to my mother, well, it'd be cheaper if he learns how to play right-handed. So here I am playing guitar right-handed. So my brother always trying to save a little bit of money. Who knows what it's like if I play guitar lefty. But again, like I said, everything's worked out pretty good for me.
Nice.
Oh, go ahead, Jake. Yeah, no worries. Well, the one thing that was cool when you were talking about, you know, Tokyo Motor Fist and, like, especially with the situation going on right now and things changing is because I'm actually an employee of Bradley Entertainment. We have you guys set for our Ballroom Blitz event that we're working our schedule back around. So this kind of goes out, like, you know, for the fans that are watching and the people that will then be watching this interview is, like, you know, exactly like... We knew who we were getting, like Tokyo Motor Fist. They're a real band. We're super duper stoked to have you, man. I mean, the guys on the panel here, they all understand, they all know. But the fact of the matter is, I mean, yeah, dude, you're Steve Brown, and we love watching you play. We respect the fuck out of watching you play. And it's going to be really exciting to get to see you and the guys rock it out as soon as we can lock that back down.
Yeah, I mean, we were so looking forward to that, you know, the Ballroom Blitz, and Brad is a good friend, and, you know, he total pro, and sadly, this happened, and, you know, look, man, we all know how many tours have been canceled, and, you know, for all my friends out there and fellow musicians and people in the industry, roadies and techs, who I feel horrible for all these people who lost all these gigs. And, you know, I'm one of the blessed ones, you know, in the sense of, you know, I'm going to be okay financially, but I feel so bad for so many of these little guys that, you know, whether it's the cover band guys who depend on those $150 weekend gigs. And, you know, I mean, I kind of went off the subject there, but, you know, again, getting back to that, this, what it's done to our business in particular, the music business and the touring business is just horrible, horrible stuff. So I'm hoping that, you know, I'm hoping we can get back on our feet sooner than later. But with that being said, we were so looking forward to the Ballroom Blitz. We're going to be with our friends in Last in Line, you know, my sometimes bandmate Vivian Campbell with Def Leppard. But with Last in Line, we were going to be playing with them and Tora Tora and all the other great bands. And just a terrible thing. But as always, we know rock will save us and we will be back. You know, hopefully, I don't know what they were talking about. I heard rumors of maybe October now, but I guess we're going to have to see. But when we do come back, you know, the cool thing is that I think the record, the new Tokyo Motor Fist record, will be released. So it'll be out and, you know, probably be able to play more. We were only going to be playing one new song off the record. But I think, you know, probably with the postponement of this, we'll be able to play a couple more new ones, which would be really cool.
Very cool. Hey, Steve, here's a couple part question. So you're such a diverse guitarist. All the bands you've been in, how do you adapt your style into when you're playing with Phil and Def Leppard, or you're going, you know, Tokyo Motor Fist to Trixter to, you know, everything is different. Everything, you have a different sound for each element that you do. You can't sound like the way you do in Trixter with Def Leppard, you know?
Yeah, right, so right.
How do you mentally change it up that way?
Well, first, you know, I tell you that, you know, no matter what I do, the first order of business is that you got to listen to whoever it is, whether it's, you know, Phil and Vivian with Def Leppard, or, you know, Dennis DeYoung playing. I've been playing with, filling in for Dennis DeYoung for the last 5 years as well. So I played for, you know, for, it's really cool in the sense that with Def Leppard, I've gotten to play, I think I'm the only person in history who's ever done this, to play, you know, fill in guitar for both major guitar players in a Hall of Fame stadium rock and roll band. So yeah, you guys can send me a trophy for that when you get it made up.
Very cool.
But you know, and the same thing I've done with Dennis DeYoung, which I played for both guitar players, August Zadra and Jimmy Leahy, filling in for them. So and playing the Tommy Shaw and J.Y. Young guitar part. So what I always do is, first off, you got to start at the basics, you know, listen to the song. And, you know, I mean, with Def Leppard, first and foremost, you're covering iconic, classic, kind of, you know, Def Leppard is pretty much, in my book, the be all end all when it comes to the hard rock, you know, the pop hard rock that we all love and, you know, love so much. To me, they're number one. So that was a band that I started listening to when they came out in 1980. So one cool thing is, it's always great when you get asked to play in a band that's pretty much your favorite band and you know their material. It's part of my DNA, just like Van Halen when I would play, you know, in a Van Halen tribute band, or when I play Van Halen, you know, there's certain things that are just in my DNA that makes it easier for me. But you have to, you know, you got to be true to what the solos are. You know, you can't play Photograph by Def Leppard and whether I'm playing Phil's solo, you got to give people, it's an iconic solo. You know, I don't think if anybody ever filled in for Neil Sean with Journey, you can't make up your own solo to Don't Stop Believing. But with that being said, you know, you can still put your own stamp on it and put your own version of it. And that's what I do with every band that I play with. Like, I learn the idea, but I always have to put my certain, you know, like when I played the Photograph solo, you can see this on YouTube. When I played the Photograph solo with Def Leppard, I pretty much did the whole thing note for note, but the end, instead of doing, Phil does a really fast picking thing, like an Al Di Meola type thing, you know, that you know, I'm sort of doing it here, but that's not really my bag. So I did more of a legato thing that more fits me. And I think it sounded great. You know, Phil and Vivian and Joe, everybody, they complimented me. So it's just a matter of, you know, and I learned this years ago from like Steve Vai, you know, to where I always love the fact that when Steve Vai came and played with David Lee Roth, you know, and was doing the Van Halen stuff, he did it his way. You know, and being for me, being one of the biggest Van Halen fans in the world and kind of a, how do I say it, like an expert on Eddie's style and playing, and nothing bothers me more than when I see like these guys playing, trying to play Van Halen and trying to do it note for note. And no one can ever play Eddie's stuff like the way Eddie plays it. So I'd rather hear somebody put their own little twist on it and make it their own, because I think it sounds more soulful and natural when you do that. So that's what I do when it comes to the lead guitar playing. Of course, when you're playing a song like Bringing On the Heartbreak, there's no room to change any notes, you know, in the verse parts and whatnot. And funny story, one of the nights, one of the first time when I played in 2015, when I filled in for Vivian at the beginning of the 2015 tour, I had some problems with the guitar cutting out and they couldn't change channels. So I had to kind of mute the strings. Like, I don't know if you can hear this, but like, you know, I was doing like a muting thing. And there's video of it too. And after the show, Joe goes to me, "Oh, you can't, what were you doing in Heartbreak? You were kind of playing it. It sounded like Van Halen, you know?" And I'm like, "Well, sorry, dude. I couldn't, you know, they couldn't change the channel to get me a clean sound. So I couldn't clean it up good. So that's what I did." But it was just a funny, funny thing. But, you know, that's pretty much what you do. You know, you have to just kind of, you know, you stay true. Like Dennis DeYoung, I think he said it best. He said, "Stay true to, you know, the core elements of the solos and whatnot, but put your own stamp on it, you know, to where people know it's you." And that's, you know, that's kind of what I try to do. But with that, you know, within reason, there's certain solos, again, you know, there's certain things where there's really no room to do anything else. But, you know, I think no matter what, you know, I kind of, like I said, I always kind of put my own stamp on whatever I'm doing.
That's very cool.
Steve.
All
right, go for it then.
When Trixter started out, did you ever consider moving to LA to make it, to get a record deal?
Never, man. We were so, and still are, you know, from PJ and myself, you know, we're so New Jersey, and this is where, you know, this is where our heart is, where our families are. As much as, you know, as much as I love traveling the world, one of my favorite things in life is coming back from a tour, coming back and be able for where I live up in northern New Jersey up here. And I live in a town called Ringwood, and, you know, man, coming over the mountains, there's nothing like Jersey. I think it's the greatest place in the world. So, with that being said, no way, shape, or form did we ever think about, we never needed to be honest with you, because, you know, when I started Trixter back in 1983, that was the beginning of the whole Jersey sort of, you know, the wave that was starting. You know, that was right when Bon Jovi got signed, and then, you know, it was starting to take off. It was a small wave, but we knew we were going to be a part of it. And then, you know, in 85, when 7,800 degrees Fahrenheit, when Bon Jovi went gold with that, we were at their gold record show when they opened for Rat. And that was when kind of the ball started really rolling. And, you know, and that's kind of when Skid Row formed. And there was a scene starting to bubble in New Jersey that was totally happening. Very much different than what was happening in L.A., which was a phenomenal scene as well. But we just never needed to go there to make it. You know, we became, you know, like I said, we were part of that wave. And we were like the third band of the, you know, let's say the New Jersey hard rock phenomenon. It was Bon Jovi, Skid Row, and then Trixter. You know, and we did it the old-fashioned way. We just built it up, and, And as you all know, you guys were around in 1986, man. You know, when Slippery When Wet came out, yeah. Man, everybody was looking at fans. Every record label was looking at fans from New Jersey. And that was when I looked at the guys and said, man, put on your seatbelts. We're going for a ride, kids. And that's sure enough what we did. And 2.5 years later, we had a record deal. And, you know, in September of 89, we were out in L.A. making our first record. So, and that was an incredible experience. So, yeah, we went to L.A. to make our first record. You know, we recorded most of the debut album out in California. And that was an unbelievably incredible experience, a great learning thing. And, you know, and it was also one of those times where I realized how much I loved New Jersey and loved being home, because as great as L.A. is, and it's still to this day, I think a lot of people get affected by it. It's one as all the glitz and glamour that it has. It's also one of the loneliest places on earth. You know, if you're stuck there, and I found that out in 2014 when I was there. I was kind of stationed out there with Def Leppard for about a month. While they were on tour with Kiss, I was rehearsing, getting ready to do my thing, and I was kind of sent out there to kind of be ghosting in case they needed me, because Vivian was getting his treatments and whatnot. But I was living out there. I was out there by myself, man, and it was a lonely time, you know. And being, like I said, it was summertime in L.A. The weather was beautiful, the palm trees, but something about it, man, is definitely, again, you know, to quote, you know, the great Judy Garland, you know, Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz, there's no place like home. And for me, there's no place like New Jersey.
Steve, let me read a couple of messages. I don't want to forget about the people who are on the other side. So Matt Potter says, I'm going to go with Matt Potter later. So we have somebody, Renee Mark Hall says, hey, Jay Hun. Is that your girlfriend?
I thought this was to be for Steve.
Next. Well, Jay, I mean, I have to read all of them. We have, you know, this is an equal opportunity, man. So Darla Sherry says, Steve Brown and I share the same the birthday. Matt Porter says, ask him to please play some Trixter riffs. I think he had a typo there. I don't know if you can plug that beauty that you have there. And then, well, we have a couple more. I'm going to read them later. Steve, I want to know so badly about your experience with Def Leppard.
Mm-hmm.
If you can tell me, because, you know, I'm from Argentina, and in Argentina we pronounce the bands so differently. So, you know, but I want to know an experience, a memory, something that you can share, you know, from that, you know, from those years, you know, from that.
Well, you know, it's, what can I say? You know, it's 30 plus years of friendship with those guys. You know, I met them on the Hysteria tour in 1987, was the first time I met them. And, you know, and then fast forward to 1989 when Trixter got signed. How we got signed and how I became friends with Def Leppard was by their old manager, Peter Mensch, Q Prime, who manages Metallica and the Chili Peppers now. Peter Mensch and Cliff Bernstein, you know, at that time, and they were the biggest rock and roll managers, and they were the ones helping out Trixter and helping out our managers. So the first order of business, and Peter Mensch, you know, and I still eternally grateful to him for doing this. You know, he would take our demo tape all around to all the record company guys, and he would say, Trixter, this is the new Def Leppard. They're going to be opening for Def Leppard on their next tour. Though that never happened. What happened was we became friends with those guys, and myself in particular became really good friends, and still to this day, you know, with Phil Collin. And, you know, and Phil has been like, you know, he's like my British brother and my godfather. You know, he's been such a supporter of mine from day one, you know, back in the Trixter days. And I used to go to his apartment in the city back, right after the Hysteria tour ended and stuff. And he was playing me the demos for Adrenalize, and just a real great role model. And so long story short, fast forward to 2013, when Vivian got diagnosed with cancer, Phil was the one who stepped up and told Joe and Sav. He said, I got the guy. It's Steve. And I was friends with Joe and Sav, and I've known all the guys, you know, since I was 17 years old. So they knew me very well. I've been at every tour that they've ever done since Hysteria. I would go to all the shows. So I don't think there was anybody who knew the show and knew, you know, how to step in more than I did. And the reason, the most important reason why I got the gig was Joe and Phil were such big fans of 40 Foot Ringo. And that was where, you know, of course, I was the singer in that band, you know, and that was where everybody, I don't know, I think kind of the world kind of saw that, you know, my lead vocal abilities. And that was the most important thing for getting the Def Leppard gig and those guys bringing me in, you know, and it was a no-brainer. And also the, you know, the personality vibe, you know, and that's the most important thing when you're on the band. It's not so much how great of a singer or player you are. It's how you get along with everybody and being cool. And I'm a family guy. Those guys are all families, you know, have families and, yeah, you know, kids and stuff. So it's very important, you know, to be able to sit in the dressing room and I'm not coming in, you know, rocking, you know, a bunch of girls slugging a bottle of Jack Daniels, you know what I mean? So that's kind of how that happened. And, you know, the real reason, and we're coming up on an anniversary, how it all happened was in 2012, I did a show with Phil. I did on Fox News. There was a Mike Huckabee show. And I did a little stint with Phil. And it was the first time Phil and I ever did anything where we played kind of professionally together. And I was kind of, you know, singing and playing with him. And we did a kind of a weird version of Pour Some Sugar on Me. But I remember him calling me afterwards going, oh, man, I couldn't believe how great we blended. Our voices blended. And that show, and you can find it online, it's pretty cool. That was kind of what kind of, I think, in his head was like, wow, if we ever needed somebody, Steve's really very the guy. Cool, that's what happened. Cool. So, you know, and that's what it was, man. And, you know, I mean, I guess, what, 15 or 16 shows later, wow. You know, and wow. True Def Leppard fashion, you know, here, my first show with them was Wembley Stadium in 2014 in front of 90,000 people. So, you know, I got to always tip my hat to those guys for keeping me on my toes. You know, it wasn't right. Like, we're going to ease you into this, Steve. Okay. We're going to do a club gig. Nah, we're going to throw you into the Lions. You know, you're going to go play, you know, Wembley Stadium in front of 90,000 people with Def Leppard on your first gig. And, you know, so that's what I did.
Very cool. Everybody, we are here with Steve Brown, man. What a pleasure. This gentleman here, you know, is such a rocker, you know, like a great musician, great guy. Everybody, you know, behind the scenes, you know, I'm talking about the rock environment, the musicians, everybody loves you, man. Like, you're such a cool guy, and I really appreciate that you're here with us tonight. Jay, you are very quiet. I passed the token to you, man, if you want to ask a question or say something.
Absolutely. I'm more than happy to do that. Actually, Steve, this is kind of a funny story that you probably have heard from the guys, because I've actually got a very cool relationship with Rubik's Cube over the years. Myself and the late, great David Z were actually very close. But I used to show up to a lot of Rubik's Cube's gigs in Trixter t-shirts, and they used to take pictures of me to send to you. And I don't know if they ever made it to you, but Sherry used to love that.
Oh, always, man. Always. I always got those pictures and always loved it. And, you know, it's, man, God, I miss David every day. And, yeah, Rubik's, Sherry and the Rubik's Cube gang, that's, you know, been my, you know, one of my most important gigs over the last, since we're going on 7 years now. And, you know, here we are, you know, talking about them and you showing up at gigs wearing a Trixter shirt. But yeah, they would always send me the pictures. And that was probably, yeah, a lot of that was at the, you know, when I was with Leppard and, you know, traveling with them and whatnot. But always appreciated, man. I always, you know, and Angel, thanks for wearing your Trixter shirt. I always love to see that.
Very cool.
Absolutely, man. But the one thing I did want you to talk a little bit about was actually, I've always been a big fan. I mean, we all are fans of music videos. The music world is fans of music videos. But I also always love live music videos. And I wanted you to talk a little bit about One in a Million, considering that that was one of the, probably the first big Trixter video. And it was shot at a show in New York, from my understanding.
Yeah, it was shot at a place in, I think it was Suffern or Spring Valley, New York, called the World Stage. And yeah, and that was it. But yeah, it was, One in a Million was, you know, the second video, second single and video off the debut album. Give It to Me Good, of course, was the song that's on the map. That was number one. But yeah, I mean, that was an incredible time for us. I mean, we how do I say, you know, I say it all the time. It's a cliche, but every dream we ever had and I ever had came true a million times over with Trixter. I mean, it was just one of those. It's a movie. It's everything you can ever imagine and more. And, you know, I just am so thankful that, first off, that I was a part of that whole 80s hard rock scene. You know, even though our record came out in 1990, we were full on part of the, you know, the 80s. We were one of the last bands. I think it was us and Firehouse were the last two bands to make a mark of that genre. Firehouse certainly was the last, you know, because they came out after we did. But I thank God we caught it when we did, because damn, man, the end of 1991 into 92, shit changed real quick.
Yeah.
So, right. Steve, real quick, we have a great mutual friend and endorser and endorsee, Mr. Adam Reaver.
Yes, indeed. There it is. Look, there's the bridge right there.
Show the clock. So let's take it another angle instead of going the music. How the heck did you wind up with Brewer? Jim Brewer.
A goat boy. Jim's been a friend for a while. You know, he's been a buddy for a long time. PJ and I met him. We were on stage with Metallica a couple years ago, like 15 years ago at Giant Stadium. We were standing there watching Metallica, and I'm standing next to Jim Brewer, and we just got to talking. And, you know, we have so many mutual friends, you know, between Eddie Trunk and, you know, Don Jameson and Jim Florentine and everybody else on the scene. With Brewer, Chris Jericho. So long story short, you know, Jim just, you know, after a couple years ago, he really wanted to put together a solid band for his live show. And he called me up and was like, hey, are you into doing this? And the timing was right. And I was totally all about it. And, you know, Jim would come over to my studio here and we would work on ideas. You know, we really had a lot of potentially great ideas that never came to fruition for his show. But it was certainly, you know, we did, I think, about 8 months worth of shows, and it was awesome. You know, we were doing a residency at the Paramount in Long Island, and we had this awesome stage set that was brought in by our good buddy Rob Long, who he does production for Kiss and for Motley Crue. So we had Motley Crue's backdrop, we had Kiss's fake cabinets, and so we had this incredible live setup, and it was just so much fun. You know, it was just a great, great experience. And I would come out and do this acoustic thing with Jim, where I would just kind of noodle and kind of play acoustic stuff while Jim was telling stories about growing up in Long Island and working at Sears. And it was a really, really great time. And I wish it lasted longer, but Jim had other ideas. And but anybody who saw the show loved it. You know, we did some really, really cool things with the music. You know, we would do things where we would sometimes play straight songs. Like when Jim jammed with Billy Joel a couple years ago, he told a big story that, you know, about how he got to jam with Billy Joel at the Garden. And then, of course, that led into the show where, we're going to have to play You Shook Me All Night Long. So that was cool. But then we would do other things where we did this thing where we played Mean Street by Van Halen, but we didn't play the song. Jim just talked about growing up in Long Island and kind of, you know, growing up where he did, and some funny stories about, you know, the mean streets of Valley Stream. So it was really creative and just a great, and I love Jim and I love all of his people and his friends and stuff like that and his family. He treated, you know, PJ, myself, and Joey Quesada, we were the band, and Adam Reaver was my tech on that. So yeah, we had so much fun together. It was a really close-knit group, and, you know, Jim Brewer is, you know, he's a brother and I love him dearly.
Well, you've had a great career, you know, doing this. Everything from, look, starting 17, doing the Van Halen thing all the way up to Brewer and then going out with Def Leppard. I mean, you know, so what are your goals? Where do you see yourself 10 years from now? What do you see yourself doing? I mean, you're a hell of a side guy. And there's nothing wrong with that either.
Yeah. Well, hey, look. I'm not, like, again, I say it all the time. I'm one of the luckiest guys in the world. I am so blessed. Every dream I ever had came true a million times over at this point, you know. It really doesn't get much better than, you know, I mean, sadly, we're in this crappy situation in the world, and I send out all my love and blessings to everybody to stay healthy and stay home. Make sure you do that. For all you musicians out there, it's a great time to write a new record. So for me, I've been living in the studio and writing, recording. I'm transferring all my recordings from back from 1986. Here, I'm going to give you guys a little sneak peek. Here's a receipt. This is the first receipt from February of 1986 from Sam Ash Music. I bought this analog tape, this Ampex tape, and this is what I recorded the first Trixter demos on with our friend John Chrissy, the producer. Here's the track sheet, still in good shape. But so yeah, that's what I'm doing, man. I'm you know, preserving my history and the band's history. So I'm looking forward to getting in and remixing this stuff and, you know, getting it out there for all of you guys, all the fans, and, you know, mostly for myself to have all this stuff because it's so cool. So staying busy. 10 years from now, brother, I think just keep doing what I'm doing. I mean, honestly, I can honestly say this. I feel that right now I'm better than I ever was. I feel better than ever. You know, just the other day I celebrated 1 year of sobriety, so I don't party anymore, which is a good thing. And I'm loving life, man, and I feel like I'm at the top of my game. So I think it's kind of a new beginning for me, and I think this new record, Tokyo Motor Fest, and the title of the new record is called Lions, and it's very fitting for where my head is and for what the world needs right now. And I just feel like, you know, the next 10, 20, 30, man, I plan on being here a long, long time. And, you know, look, man, you know, I was with my buddies, you know, Gene and Paul and the Kiss guys and David Lee Roth a couple weeks ago.
I was with you there.
Yeah, man, I know. And you know, look, man, what's Gene going to be, 71 this year? You know, look, I'm a kid next to all these guys. And, you know, if you really want to look at it, look at Mick Jagger and Keith Richards. They're still out there kicking ass. Paul McCartney. So for me, I'm still a kid in this game like I was, you know, back in the Trixter days. You know, they used to say to me and PJ, you know, all the time, man, oh, my God, you guys are kids. And we were, but we still are in the sense, you know, shit, I'm going to be 50 in July. PJ is going to be 48. We're still kids if you really look at it, you know, so yeah. It's a pretty cool thing. And, you know, like I tell Joe Elliott all the time, you know, dude, even you guys, even the Leppard guys, you know, those guys are only 60. They're still young, and they're in my opinion, they're at the top of their game. So yeah. I think it's a key thing of being, you know, look, dude, it's no secret. You got to be physically in shape. So we all, you know, kind of, I certainly have always followed a healthy regimen, and Phil Collin has been, you know, definitely my guru when it comes to that, you know. And I think, you know, as we all get older, that's one of the most important things. And if you want to still fit into a size 29 pair of skin tight pants, you got to keep yourself healthy, man, and look good, you know. And, you know, hey, man, I'm just pushing at this point. I'm just pushing, you know, to see what and I'm hoping and praying that our good buddy Vince Neil pulls it together and, you know, surprises us all and loses a shit ton of weight and gets his ass back in shape for this summer tour that's supposed to happen this summer. So that's it, man. But again, like I said, man, I'm just so, so blessed in so many ways. And I'm just so excited for the future.
Yeah, Steve.
That's great.
Steve, two questions. One, tell me again the name of a new album of Tokyo Motor. Motor Fist. Sorry, man, about that. Tell me the new title of a new album.
The title is Lions.
Lions. And where
it can be Lions. That's the title track. That's also a song on the record that, like I said, man, is going to have, when you hear it, the meaning of it, especially in what we're living in right now, you know, the way the world's been in the last couple years, but where we are right now, this is a song that the world needs. And one other cool fact about the song is that I was able to get my good friend and sometimes band leader, Dennis DeYoung, played a keyboard solo. He played a phenomenal keyboard solo on it using his original Oberheim 8 keyboard that he used on the Stick stage, you know, on all the Sticks back in the day. And it is incredible.
And how can I get more information about Tokyo Motor Fest? Sorry, I have my mind in so many things right now. I have thinking about seven. I'm controlling, you know, the... Doesn't matter. Yeah.
It's all right, dude. After this, you got to promise me. You just say Tokyo Motor Fest. Say it 10 times and you'll have it in your
Tokyo
head.
Tokyo Motor Fest. Listen, how can I get more information about Tokyo Motor Fest online, you know, on the social media? Can I follow you on Instagram? What's your Instagram?
That's really it. Me on Twitter. I mean, you know, with Tokyo Motor Fest, Frontiers Records, they own the name. They own the whole thing. So it's kind of up to them to do that, but they haven't done that. I don't understand why, but it's not I don't know. But you follow me, you follow our guys, you know, I'm on Instagram, Steve Brown Rocks on Twitter. You follow Greg Smith on Instagram and Twitter, and Chuck and Greg, you know, and Ted. Everybody's around. You can find out what's going on.
Awesome.
But as soon as the record is, you know, ready for release, the world is going to know.
What are you writing a lot? Tell me, because, well, we were talking about One in a Million, right? So Jay Oakley was talking about that song. Are you back into that, inspiration, you know, of writing songs like that?
I'm always, you know what, man, look, one of the greatest things that I've had in my life is when I, you know, the success of Trixter enabled me to buy a really nice house. And the first order of business was where I am now, to have a house that I could build my own recording studio. So I've had this studio here for, I'm going on 27 years now, living in this house. And it was the greatest investment I ever made. And it was always, you know, very much inspired by Eddie Van Halen, my good buddy and my idol and my mentor and my brother and my friend. You know, Ed was his studio 5150 that I've been at a couple times. It was always my dream to have that. And so this is, you know, kind of my 5150 that I call, you know, jokingly, I call it 6160, you know, that's no real code, but, you know, so I'm always working on stuff, whether it's doing stuff for other bands, you know, I write and produce for other people, I mix, I do all things that nobody even knows about, I do TV stuff, commercials, so every day I come down here, you know, but with this kind of self-imposed, you know, you stay at home thing, it certainly works itself from somebody like me, because this is what I always do anyway. You know, when I'm home, you know, my kids are at school and, you know, I spend my time. I take a good 6 hours a day. I'm down in the studio anyway, whether it's working on Tokyo Motor Fist, Trixter, or mixing or producing somebody else's. So,
that's
amazing. You know, that's really
amazing.
It.
That's amazing that you can work off something that makes you happy, right? That not everybody can, you know, make a living.
Hey, listen, this is the dream. This is the dream, dude. I'm living it, man. You know, and I you know, and it's, you know, and again, it comes down to being just such a lucky guy and having great fans all around the world and friends like you guys who have supported me and all my fans. And, you know, it's a blessing, and, you know, it's a great thing. And, you know, getting back to the record and recording, you know, we mixed the Tokyo Motor Fist record. Another cool thing about it, which most people know yet, is that Bruno Ravel, my brother from Danger Danger, he mixed the record. He mixed the Tokyo Motor Fist record. So he's another one who lives in the next town over from me in Jersey here. He's got a great studio in his house. So, you know, another great thing. I would go over to his house every day, and it was like we were just hanging out in his house, having coffee, you know, mixing the record. And so now I think we're going to do some other work together.
Excellent.
So we're really excited. But It's a beautiful thing, man. It is.
Man. And we have 52 minutes of show already, man. We've been unbelievable. Time flies, man. But, anybody, let's do one more round of questions.
I have another question.
Yeah, there you go.
I have a question.
Go for it.
Do you have any fun stories from the Blood, Sweat, and Tears tour with Firehouse and Warrant? Any fun stories?
It's the Blood, Sweat, and Beers tour.
That's right.
That was one of the greatest times in our lives, and I think if you ask anybody in Warrant, anybody in Firehouse, and certainly the Trixter guys, man, it was a traveling party that, you know, tore up America. Like, I never toured with Motley Crue and I never toured with Van Halen back in the 70s or 80s, but I can definitely say that it was pretty close, the debauchery and the partying that was going on. But, you know, what was so cool about it was every guy in every band became such good friends, and still to this day. You know, I mean, I see the Firehouse guys and I see the Warrant guys a couple times a year. And honestly, when we all get together, we still kind of have a code language that we spoke on that tour together. You know, all the inside jokes, all that stuff still rings true. And I see Michael Foster or Bill Leverty, you know, we say jokes in that we are the only ones who kind of know the punchline. But it's so cool. Same with Eric Turner and Joey Allen. You know, and Jerry Dixon, when I see those guys. But funny stories, they're too many to tell. I mean, I can certainly tell you that the Warrant guys certainly taught the Trixter guys and the Firehouse guys how to party to another level. I mean, those guys, man, they were fucking out of control. But they every night, and God rest his soul, Janie Lane, man, that dude smoked and drank like I've never seen anybody. But when he got up on stage and he was still smoking and drinking, that guy was untouchable. And at that point, and I said it many times in interviews, and, you know, I remember Pete and I would watch him from the side of the stage, and we would look at each other, and I said to myself, and I would say this to other people, he was at that time one of the best front men in rock and roll that you could ever see. And anybody that ever saw that tour, from the way he sang, he was playing piano, he was playing guitar, his raps in between, you know, and man, I would see what he would do drinking wise behind the curtain. And we'd be halfway done with a bottle of tequila. And I don't know how he was able to even talk, but he never slurred, and he was smoking cigarettes. I mean, he was unstoppable at that point. Sadly, you know, that lifestyle got the best of him, but it was just an incredible time. I mean, you know, I'll tell you, you know, for one of the coolest nights of the tour was definitely the night that we sold out Red Rocks Amphitheater in the Denver, Colorado area. And to play that, I've only played that venue once in my life. And to play it sold out with Warrant and Firehouse, it was a beautiful summer night playing Red Rocks, which anybody seen the footage or, you know, you can go online. It is one of the most incredible venues to play in the world. And we got to play it. One of the most memorable nights. But, I mean, look, every tour that I've ever done, the memories are, you know, everything is so embedded in my head. You know, I remember everything from the Scorpions tour, the Poison tour, our first time playing arenas, you know, the Striper tour, our first tour out on the road, Don Dokken solo. Every tour that we ever did, I remember, and it was just incredible. And even when shit was going south for us, the Undercovers tour that we did in 1994 and 95, we still had an incredible time. We were driving fans around the country on our own, you know. So look, getting back to it, and, you know, we'll wrap this up. You know, again, you're looking at one of the luckiest guys in the world, and it just keeps getting better and better. So
awesome. Steve, I cannot thank you enough, brother. This is amazing. You know, I had a great time, you know, like listening to your stories, you know, your experience. you know, that all your new projects, the old project. This is amazing, man. I'm so happy to see you, you know, 100%, 110%, you know, and with all that.
500%.
There you go. With all that
can
energy.
Can I say one more thing?
Yeah, go for it, bro.
No, 5 years ago when I did the interview with you at the Stanhope House, mm-hmm. I was nervous as hell and just super starstruck, like, damn, I'm here with Steve. Just wanted to say.
Yeah, I remember that. It's time, dude. You know, look, there's never, you know, look, I've met some of the biggest and the best in rock and roll. And, you know, the cool thing is that everybody, you know, including myself, I'm no different than you guys. I just do something different, you know, and that's the way I've always looked at it. You know, that was always our attitude with Trixter back in the day. You know, we were always the guys that would be hanging outside the tour bus, you know, playing football with our fans. And, you know, we never looked at like, you know, that we had to have any barriers with anybody. You know, I mean, of course, certain times, you know, when there were like near riots with us, with fans, you know, you have to stand behind a barricade. But, you know, dude, it's really what it is. You know, we're all humans. So let's just, you know, and now more than ever, let's be, you know, we got to try to be more human than ever. But at least stay away from each other.
Yeah. Well, we're doing Skype, man. It can get better. We can cough with no problem, man.
You can touch the screen. You won't get sick.
Bobby, Angel, Jay, Steve, you want to say something?
I got something real quick. So, Steve, I noticed on your website you got work with Steve. Personally, I would love to work with Steve. I'm working with a couple bands, Mach 22. I'm producing their album right now. Uh-huh. But I need a kick in the ass to do my next album. And Adam and I have been talking about it. So with that, maybe let's talk.
You know where to find me. And it's certainly, you know, and for everybody out there, you know, it's
right in Doylestown, man. I'm not that far from you.
Yeah, there you go. And, you know, and in this day and age, you know, the great thing is you do records, you know, as we all know with you know, the internet, everybody's kind of right next door. So, you know, making records, Dropbox, send me files, whatever you need. But it's a beautiful thing. We'll definitely talk about it. And, you know, I had a great time, man.
Jay, you want to say something? You want to say the final?
Yeah, I'll just throw in something quick for myself and then a quick question for the fans, because I know they're going to want to know. And first of all, like, I also want to thank you not only for just the great Trixter album, Steve, especially your most recent one, Human Era. I got to tell you, man, that record spoke to me on a pretty heavy level, especially the song Midnight in My Eyes.
Yeah.
So I really want to thank you for that one. And I feel like us as a group, and with the courtesy that you've shown us, I feel we'd be doing a small injustice to the fans that are watching. What can you tell us about Trixter? Are you guys kind of doing separate projects and stuff like that? What can you tell us about, you know, Trixter, and would we get to see you guys coming up at some point?
Well, right now, you know, hey, come, I think it's May 29th of this year, we got the 30th anniversary of the debut record. We are certainly planning something. As you know, we haven't really played with Gus and Pete in a couple years. They're, you know, I'd be lying if I was not to say that they're, you know, things aren't, it's not a happy situation right now. Pete and I and PJ have spoken and we're cool. There seems to be no issue. Honestly, we haven't gotten any offers for any gigs. You know, M3 didn't call for a 30th anniversary. And, you know, look, the last 10 Trixter shows that have been put on, I've been singing, you know. And so it's kind of like we know who the power players are in Trixter. It's PJ and I. So I don't know what's going to happen at this point, but we're here, you know, and I have, you know, Joey can play with us or whoever. Do I think the all original band is going to play together anytime soon? I highly doubt it, but that really, you know, look, we're in this day and age. How many all original bands are there out there? But we're looking at celebrating, you know, the 30th anniversary of the first record. We have, we're talking about doing a reissue, kind of a vinyl reissue. And, you know, we're talking about it, but unfortunately with the situation right now, everybody's kind of shut down. So we can't really, I'm more focused on Tokyo Motor Fest, but you know, May 29th of 2020 is the 30th anniversary. I think I might have a trick up my sleeve for a little anniversary present for the fans and whatnot. But, you know, right now that's really it. You know, I mean, there's really nothing more I can tell you than that. You know, we, like I said, we have booking agents. We haven't been given any offers for anything. And, you know, Pete has said, you know, if something comes our way, you know, I'd love to try to be able to do it. Look, the reality of it is that we all have families and we have responsibilities. So, you know, kind of, you know, Pete's got a day job and that's his main responsibility, taking care of his kids. And, you know, so that's what it is. PJ and I, we're rocking and rolling all the time, whether it's with Eric Martin or, you know, PJ's back playing with Ra right now. So when the business picks back up, you never know. I mean, we still got a lot of time left and, you know, I'm very positive and praying that, you know, this coronavirus thing kind of winds up in, you know, a month or two, you know, that we can all kind of get back to normalcy for this country and the rest of the world. Yeah. But I don't know what's going to happen. So, you know, but with Trixter, you know, look, anything can happen. And, you know, all I can say is, yeah, you know, Human Era, what a great record. New Audio Machine, what a great record. And it's a testament, you know, to where, you know, like I say, man, you know, age and, you know, there's a lot of bands, I'm not going to slag anybody, but, you know, there's a lot of bands that phone in new records, let's say, to where they really don't care. And it's kind of a cash grab and you can hear those. And I'm not going to name bands, but for myself, and you guys should know this, and the fans, anything I do, I don't give 100%. I give 500%.
Awesome.
And it's very cool. So awesome. There's no slack in there. So when it came time to do the new Audio Machine record, you know, and there were certain guys in the band who were apprehensive about doing it, I told them, I said, you got to trust me. And I said, we're going to make a great record. And sure enough, we did. And that gave the whole band confidence to where we said, you know, I said, well, let's make another record. And we made Human Era, which I think, you know, I think Human Era and New Audio Machine stand right up there with the debut album and with Here. You know, this is good. And that's a pretty cool thing to say for a band that hadn't made a record in close to 20 years, you know, and that's, you know, that's really cool. But yeah, you know, but getting back to Trixter, well, I don't know what to tell you. You know, but all I know is that the memories and the, you know, the music is still there. So there's a lot of, again, like I said, a lot of unreleased stuff. And nice. I'm transferring the history. We, PJ and I, have, you know, probably 10 years of, here's another thing for you. 10 years of the videotapes, transferring all the stuff. This is, you're going to love this. So 2022 is the anniversary of the Here record. And one guarantee I can tell you is we are going to have a serious deluxe reissue of the Here record, because that was the record. That's, in my opinion, Trixter's crowning moment. Sadly, the record came out at the worst possible time, but it's an incredible record. And, you know, I have all the videos, all the footage of making the record. This is the video of us making the Road of 1,000 Dreams video. So all this stuff is getting digitized. We're going to probably put together like a cool documentary for it. So, you know, there's whether the original band ever plays together or not, I don't know, but there is going to be a lot more Trixter material.
Excellent.
You know, audio and visual for everybody.
Excellent.
And
excellent.
We really appreciate you talking to us about that, Steve. Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Psycho, you've been Steve. You've been quiet. Like that's your time.
Okay. One more thing. Don't forget that Steve is going to be performing at that benefit that I am hosting and emceeing in June. Hopefully, if it does happen. For Youth Mental Health with Eric Martin Band, his Friends of Warrant, Firehouse, April Wine, let me see who else. Jack Russell's Great White.
Yeah, Lynch that's one out in Pennsylvania, right? June 6th out in Pennsylvania.
Yes, I'm very PA.
I'm looking forward to that.
Me too. I'm going to be the host with the most. So I can't wait to, you know, have a bottle of water with you.
That's right. As I tell everybody, instead of doing shots to Jaeger now, I do shots of seltzer. So beautiful
thing. Yeah, I'm drinking Lacroix. That's my new
drink. There you go.
Guys, thank you so much.
I want to say thank you to Steve for taking the time. Very much appreciate it. Appreciate you.
You rock, Steve. You rock, buddy.
Thank you, Steve.
Give us the website.
Yes.
So, and always remember, guys, like I tell you, it's no hobby.
Excellent.
Nice.
Guys, thank you so much. Dude, an hour went through, and I didn't even feel it, man. It was like 5 minutes. Steve, you're awesome. You rock. This is your house, man. This is your show. Anything you want to promote, anything you want to say to the world, this is a channel that you own it. Yep. You know, we love you, dude. These are my brothers. These are four monsters. I'm nobody. I'm just, you know, sneaking in. But these are Steve Prestop, Jay Oakley, Angel Alamo, and Bobby Dreher. These are the real deal. Guys, I see you next Wednesday, 9 p.m. Steve, you rock. And I don't know. Rock and roll!
Later, man.
Thanks so much.
Steve, I'll touch base with you, man.
You are listening to the M.